Sunday Pentecost. It used to be called Whit Sunday in my day when I was young. Now we're talking about Pentecost. And then to Trinity Sunday. But I want to linger still on the theme of Ascension time. After all, this is where we are. And I want to take you to some verses, words at the end of Luke's Gospel, where just before Jesus ascends, we read, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. He lifted up his hands and blessed them. I believe this is what worship is essentially all about. And it's impossible not to miss that expression of celebration and joy. On the side of Jesus comes the blessing. He lifts his hands and blesses. On the part of the disciples, it's a time of worship, great joy, and waiting for the coming of the Spirit. Now, if that is what ascension is, essentially means, why does the one church almost completely pass it by? It's the most ignored of all festivals, and yet I believe it's one of the most important of them all. Of course, the idea of Jesus returning to his Father is one that clashes very sharply with our view of our planet. Heaven is not up there any more than hell is down there. So the vivid idea of a return is more to do with accommodation to our limited idea of what it is to see. Now, some of you are wearing bifocal glasses. I've got a variant lens on my glasses, but if you've got the bifocal, there's a line going across, isn't there? And that's enabling you to do two things. One is to see things close up, and the other one is to see them at a distance. It's rather like the way you've put us to sleep for these few days. We're up in the Renaissance on the 61st floor, and we have the most glorious view of the river. Now, when you're up there, and this morning it would be so far up, we couldn't see a thing because of the clouds. But on the other days, we could see one river below us, we could see the boats moving slowly, we could see little people like ants walking along, and the cars. And it's only when you get down, you can see actually the waves on the river, you can see the expression on people's faces. Or to give another illustration, if you've ever seen Rembrandt's wonderful oil painting, The Return of the Prodigal, then if you stand too far away, yes, the picture is still beautiful. The art critic Kenneth Clark once said it's the greatest of all paintings. If you're too far away, although you can see some details, only when you get close up, you can see the marks of the paintbrush. You can actually see clearly the hands of the Father of the Prodigal Son. The left hand, remarkably, is very masculine and rough. The right hand is smaller and feminine. What's he trying to communicate? God as mother, the Father, we don't know. But it's only when you get close up you'll realize that in the background on the left hand side of the painting, there is a woman. You cannot see her too far away. But the two sides of the picture are one, the third one and the close one. In quite the same way, ascension, you say that God has taken Christ back into himself, the Word was completed, and we get on with it in the power of the Holy Spirit. But it's the meaning that I want to be concerned with this morning. What does it mean to us, essentially? What way may it encourage us in our Christian lives? I want to bring you three things. First, it means that Jesus reigns. The emphasis, as I said earlier, is not that Jesus is not there, but he's with us all the time. He's over all. And so Ephesians says, God has highly exalted and given him a name above all names. that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. I said Ephesians, and those of you who know your Bible will say immediately, see, I didn't want you to correct me later, it was Philippians, but you spotted that, didn't you? I hate what you did. That every knee shall bow, and all things on earth and things under the earth. You see there an idea of a three-decker universe, but the attention of the writer is not on that kind of detail, but on the fact that Jesus reigns. He is King, Lord of all, and worthy of all praise and adoration. Can we grasp the force of that today? We look at our mad world around us, pick up our papers, and we can see that so much is wrong. It seems at times that no one is in control, certainly not the President, certainly not the Prime Minister of England or whatever. No one seems to be in control. Sometimes we find in our darkness and our temple that we echo in the words of Shakespeare that the whole thing is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. And when bad things happen to us, we are tempted to agree. Many of us say, you know the words perhaps, that what a friend we have in Jesus, that wonderful hymn, which I learnt as a young man. But very few people really know the background of that hymn. Joseph Scriven was an Irishman, and he had come ahead, he was engaged to be married. He went ahead to New York to find a job, get money so that his bride, the bride-to-be, could join him. And he did that successfully, and he telegraphed across to her and said, I found a job, we can get married, come as quickly as you can. But her ship went down in New York Harbor. He was broke. What did he do? He sat down at his desk and wrote, what a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who with all our sorrow share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. It takes great faith, great courage, moral and mental, to be able to say that when you lost your wife to leave. But he went on to be a great Christian leader. But you know, the meaning of that story sums up so well what Ascension essentially means. There is no tragedy that will not be redeemed, and no sadness that will never be overcome. And that also pertains to the world in which we live, your world, my world, the world in the Middle East. I think of the Middle East, where Christianity has been hollowed out by the Islamic state, driving Christians from their ancestral homes. There's a fierce hatred of Christianity among such Muslims. You see in the freedom that comes with Christianity, their huge challenge to the bigoted extremism that ends in the impoverishment of women and in the poverty of everybody. Of course it will not triumph, but in the meantime our fellow Christians there are facing something that looks like genocide, ironically exactly 100 years from the genocide of Armenian Christians at the hands of Turkish Muslims in 1915. So Ascension says to you and me that in spite of what we see, God is working his purposes out as year succeeds to year. And secondly, the Ascension carries a message that God takes human nature up into the Godhead. Now that needs some explanation. What do we mean by taking up into the Godhead? Well, Bishop John Robinson once said years ago that the Ascension is the most political tell you it's a wonderful celebration of service. In the United Kingdom, as in the United States, the churches are of the most energetic and enterprising of groups in society. And it's one that's increasingly being recognised. And if all the Christians in the United Kingdom were to be taken up suddenly, there would be a huge hole in social work and care for the very poor. One of our groups, the Trussell Group, has started the food bank movement in the United Kingdom. It grew out of the diocese of Salisbury. A small group of people, and it's now the biggest provider of food banks in the United Kingdom. It's the backbone of the law and for helping people at the very bottom. But wherever we look, and we should celebrate this, and you're doing similar things, all of you, we should celebrate this more than we do, the evidence of the power of the Christian faith. And thirdly, Ascension reminds us that our humanity is accepted, we are one with God. Yes, as we are. He knows all about our weaknesses and our faults. He knows us more than we do ourselves. And you know, when I despair, time to time, when I look at the human family and marvel at our extraordinary capacity to make a disaster of every good thing we take, I take courage from the fact that God has taken our nature into himself through Jesus, and the Ascension exclaims, look, there before the throne stands the Lord clothed with our humanity. We are accepted. We are given a glorious future through him. I was saying first at the Ascension service, you may remember this if you were there, when I was vicar of St. Nick's Durham, we had a succession of events, accidents in the congregation, several deaths of prominent people, and then came what I thought was almost the final blow, the death of one of our most supportive parishioners and a lovely youngest teacher. And I went to see her, and I must have looked very miserable, because she beamed up at me and she said, "Don't look so miserable, vicar. I'm only dying, you know." And you know, that phrase, "I'm only dying," she didn't know, because she wasn't dying. And that was a masterclass in spirituality that she gave to the young minister of 39 that day. She made me aware of the riches of the Christian faith, that death is something that faces us all, but life is the big thing. She made me aware of the riches of the Christian faith, the hope for us all. Christ is risen, and he intercedes for us. That's the message of the Ascension. So here in St. John, you have a marked church. You have a very worshipful choir and clergy. You have an energetic priest whose energy seems to be tireless. And you are one team. You are here for purpose. You are here to make this place a great place of worship and service. Celebration. I know all about the project that may be coming your way, set here in the heart of Sport 2, stadium very close to you. And Second Ascension may be saying to you, seize this moment, work together, because out of this could something come glorious to the glory of God. So in that picture I've given you of Jesus returning to his Father, he raises his arms, he blesses them, and he says, cheer up, I have conquered the world. So he has, the victory is ours, and our job is to celebrate it in the name.